Discouraged pastor, it's his church and it's still alive. Lonely missionary, sow that seed with confidence. The church is still alive. Old saint, you're not alone or forgotten. The church is still alive. It's alive, my broken-hearted friend. It's still alive. Busy mother, just keep trusting in Jesus. The church is alive. You're not alone out there serving the Lord, young student. Just keep looking to Jesus. The church is alive. And faithful Father, there's rest in the Lord. God's church is still alive. So family of God, lift your hands. Lift your hands and praise the Lord. The church, God's church triumphant, is alive. It's alive, my friend. Alive and well.
Oceans give up all the dead that are in them, the graves open wide to set captives free. A strong, mighty army, their voices are ringing the great cloud of witnesses, sings freedom song as they enter.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Are we here to praise the Lord?
Yes.
Are we here to praise the Lord?
Yes.
If you're here to praise the Lord, let me hear you say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you're here to praise the Lord, let me invite you to stand.
Amen.
All right. We're going to stand and we're going to pray for our song service.
Praise the Lord.
Sister Nicole will lead us into prayer.
Let us pray. Father, we humbly bow before your awesome presence tonight. We are exalting you because you are worthy to be praised. We thank you for keeping us through today, for providing for us, for protecting us. You have brought us into your house to worship you. We pray that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let self be denied and let Jesus alone be seen, be known, be lifted up and be exalted in this place tonight. Tune our voices and unite us. And those who are coming, Lord, bring them safe so that we can have a wonderful time tonight in your presence, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Remain standing, put your hands together and sing with us as we sing till the power of the Lord come down.
What a mighty God we serve. Praise the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. Come on, everybody.
What a mighty God we serve.
You see,
angels bow before him, and heaven and earth adore him.
Sing.
What a mighty God we serve.
Come on, everybody.
God, we serve. What a mighty God we serve.
our theme song at this time.
Righteous and heavenly Father, once more we, your people, come before you. We acknowledge, Lord, that without you we are nothing. And we are so glad, Lord, that it is because of your goodness. Keep running after us while we are here to lift up your name. We pray, Heavenly Father, that your Holy Spirit will fall afresh on each and everyone who are here tonight. Lord, we ask of you to move in this place. We pray that hearts will be watered and will find themselves willing, Lord, to give their lives to you. Heavenly Father, we are here on business for you. And so, Lord, we know that we cannot do it by ourselves. But we are so glad that you did not left us alone, because you promised that your Holy Spirit will help us in this soul winning. Lord, we pray, Lord, that as we come before you, that you will continue to give us the strength and help us, Lord, to continue to proclaim your gospel. We pray, Lord, that soul will see the need to seek you now before it is eternally too late. Lord, how can we stop praying without asking for a special strength for our evangelist? Lord, you have given him strength. You have given him your word night after night. Lord, we pray that you will continue to encourage his heart, because in times like these, we need messages from you. Continue, Lord, to do your thing while we, Lord, stand still and watch your son visual move in this place, we ask. In your son Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, everybody. God is good, and all the time. It's a wonderful privilege this evening to stand here to greet you and to welcome you into the house of the Lord. What do you say? I join with the evangelist and the team to let you know that we are grateful that you have taken this evening off to be with us. And those who are watching online, we are grateful for your viewership. We're asking that you continue to come. And also, I heard a story about a man who had a dog, and the dog was sick and was out straying. And when it became sick, it came home. The man patched the dog up, and the dog was doing well. And the dog went back out, got sick. But this time, when the dog came home, it carried home other dogs. In no wise am I suggesting that any of us are dogs. The simple point I'm making is that if your heart has been blessed each night, if God has been soothing your problems each evening, what do you need to do? Bring others who have the same challenges, because we have the same source of strength. So continue to come, continue to bring others as we continue to worship and to fellowship. And guess what? Right now, it's a good time to get acquainted. So stand with me as we sing our fellowship song as we greet each other. Stand with me, everybody. Pastor Goldburn, somewhere around, we want to welcome Pastor Goldburn as he's worshiping with us. I quickly, before I go, I got two phone cards here that were given to me that I need to give away before I leave. But just before I go down, I want you to know that there are persons who have decided that they can't wait until Sabbath to give their hearts to Jesus. We don't celebrate the right things. I said there are persons who can't wait until Sabbath to give their hearts to Jesus. So Tuesday evening, when you get here, there will be a pool right underneath the tent. Amen? And we'll be having persons giving their hearts to Jesus. And I want you to know that every single night, if there are persons who are ready and willing, the water will be troubled. Amen? And so you can talk with a Bible worker, talk with a pastor as we get ready to do that. If you're a special guest, you're a visitor, you're here with us tonight, just raise your hand. You are a special guest, a visitor. The ushers have some special gifts that we want to give to you quickly. Quickly. The ushers are coming around quickly. Have some special gifts. But if you are a visitor who invited another visitor, stand. You are a visitor who invited another visitor. Stand. You're a visitor who invited another visitor. Who are the visitors you invited? All right, so I'm not seeing anybody. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. Enjoy. Oh, there's one there. Where are your visitors that you invited? All right, so come quickly. And you have got yourself a flow phone card valued at $250. You have some talk time, amen? I have two, so don't worry yourself. Yeah, man, don't worry yourself. Make your one, don't worry yourself. No, say one, man. Say. Yeah, man, don't worry yourself. Yes, sir. All right. God bless you. Enjoy the rest of the evening. See you later.
Praise the Lord. Good night, everybody. God is good. All the time, God is good. He's no farther than I thought away. He's no farther than I thought away. He speaks to my heart. I can hear him say, I'm no farther than I thought away. If you need assurance, he can give that to you. If you need more confidence, ooh, he's got that too. If you need God's love to see you through, look no further than a thought away. So he came that you might have life and have life more abundantly. May his goodness and his mercies follow you. So when you call, he'll always hear, 'cause he's always near. He's no farther than a thought away. He's no farther than a thought away. He's no farther than I when God speaks to my heart, I can hear him say, I'm no other than a thought away. It's peace he brings with him to dry all your tears. He's got joy, joy unspeakable when your doubts appear. His omnipotent power, it can cast away all your fears. And he's no other than a thought away. Follow you. So when you call, he'll always hear. Call way he's near. He's no farther than a thought away. So he came that you might have life and have life more. Follow you, follow you. So when you call, he'll always hear. Cause he's always near. He's no other than a thought away. My child, I'm no father than a thought away. No father and a thought away. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, somebody. It's no further than a thought away. Now, God has been very, very good to us right here at 10th Square ever since we started. Am I right? Yes, we have been blessed. No, am I right? And tonight again, it is my joy and my happy privilege to ask of you to partner with us as we preach the everlasting gospel at 10th Square. Hear how you can help me. Hear how you can help the cause of God. Where are my ushers? Ushers? Oh, I tell you what, we're asking the church to stand. Stand, church, please. Stand up. Yes. Everybody that is standing, give them an envelope for the love offering. Those who are seated, give them two. Yes. 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 Quickly, quickly. Those who are standing, give them one. Those who are seated, give them two. As together, we continue to preach the everlasting gospel. For this gospel of the kingdom must be preached in all the world, in Santa Cruz, in everywhere, until Jesus comes. Amen. Every man, every woman must. Yes. And you're standing and we give God thanks for you. Amen. All right, just hold it right there. Hold it right there and we have prayer. And you continue your work. Let us pray. Oh God in the Heavenly Father, we thank you for the preaching of the gospel right here at 10th Square. We thank you, great God, that we can be in partnership with you to preach this gospel. As we do so, bless our offering now, we pray, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And God's people say, amen.
Stood in the courtroom thoughts turn my way. Looks like you're guilty. Now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no defense. And that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case. Called to the stand, God said, that covered my sin, forgiven when mercy walked in. Someday and born, how could this be, that someone so guilty had just been set free. My chains were broken. I felt born again. The moment that mercy walked in.
Servant to deliver power-packed, practical, and potent messages to stir our hearts and to trouble our complacency. Tonight, I believe, will be no exception. God has given our speaker, Pastor Glenn O. Samuels, a message to leave footprints of hope, truth, peace and direction. So just as Aaron and Hur held up the hands of Moses, I ask that you hold Pastor Samuels up in prayer as he delivers the message that God has placed on his heart. But just before Pastor does so, Sister Nesbitt will offer a special music. Be blessed.
Good night, everyone. From the moment man first disobeyed, the Father. We were then held captive by our sins. The law of God demanded a sacrifice, restoring to himself his own again. So the Lamb, his only Son, was freely offered. Atonement for our sins forever made. He innocent and holy, still God and God only, could ransom and redeem us back again. Hallelujah, praise the Lamb. Hallelujah, praise the Lamb. My heart sees his praise again. To the cross they carried him, with all our guilt and all our sins. The Lamb of God was slain for our transgressions. And on the cross those nail-pierced hands reached up to God and down to man. And just as if I never sinned, he took me in his arms. Embracing me, he willingly forgave. For mercy, grace, and love that knows no bounds. Though guilty and condemned, I know I'm free.
Sounds like you're hungry. Good evening, everybody. Now, sound like you had one dumpling. Let me see who had three. Good evening, everybody. Now you sound like you're alive and well. Welcome to the final Sunday night of the Footprints of Hope encounter out here. Tomorrow night will be our rest night. Then on Tuesday, we'll have a baptismal service. I'm looking forward to having it tonight. I'm not sure what happened. But on Tuesday evening, we'll have a baptismal service right here. On Wednesday night, we'll have our final prayer circle at the altar. And Thursday will be our rest night. And Friday night will be our final Friday evening. That's my co-preacher friend there. I love the brother, don't you know that? And then on Sabbath, our final sojourn together. I pray that a miracle will happen for a number of persons during this week. I said, I pray that a miracle will happen for a number of persons during this week. We thank God for the miracles already wrought, for the lives transformed, for the souls drawn closer to Jesus. My own heart has been blessed and watered, and I'm longing for the day when this gospel of the kingdom would have been preached to all persons. Then the end shall come. And so for all those in these parts, it has been my pleasure, notwithstanding all the challenges. It happens, but God's word must be proclaimed. Would you say amen? Amen. And the same way this one, you know, there are a number of evangelistic series going on. There's a massive one by one of my young sons in the Portmore area. There's some going on in Kingston and in the Northeast Conference and the North Conference and across the length and breadth of the globe. We thank God that the day is coming when the kingdoms of this world would have become the kingdom of our God. And we'll be home at last. Today I lay to rest one of my very good friends, one of our devoted, committed pastors. Just since November last year, well, September of last year, we talked, and I made the discovery that he wasn't doing too well, and we spoke together. It has been one of those rough encounters. And today we said farewell to Pastor Lascelles George Bonito James. We continue to lift up to Almighty God his wife, his mother, his children, and those closest to him. You know, life is so uncertain, so I left here this morning and went to the funeral and then went to Montego Bay just to peep in on the wedding of one of our staff members. But I was driving out, I was getting back for the reception. And on my way up, it's good when you have somebody you can follow. And on my way up, I found a happy driver I could follow. And slowed a bit. When I got just around that deep corner coming up from La Cove, I saw the traffic at a standstill. And I was stuck there for about half an hour. When I came up to where the fire truck and the police and the wrecker was, I said to my wife, that's the license plate I was following. That's the license plate I was following. Life is uncertain. And I don't know how many times you've heard the call of God. I may not be God's first voice to you, but I could be God's last voice to you. And you may think it's okay to procrastinate, to dilly-dally, to vacillate like a wind. Think with me. When God shut the door of the ark, all the people around the ark felt that they had life as usual. Had never rained. There was no cloud in the sky. 7 days God waited after he shut the door. Nobody knocked on it until the rain started falling. Mercy's door was closed. Listen to me, whether you're underneath this tent, the hundreds of you and those on the outside and those watching online. When the angel came to Sodom with God's last call, the men of Sodom wanted to have sex with the angel. They did not know that that was Sodom's last night. When the sun came up in the morning, the Bible said it rained brimstone and fire. And hear the preacher. Not a single young child was saved. Listen to me, sir. You are on borrowed time. Listen to me, young lady. You are on borrowed time. God will not twist your arm behind your back and drag you into the baptismal fountain. He's given you eyes to see. He's given you ears to hear. He's given you a mind you can comprehend with. And I stand tonight just as God's messenger boy. Prepare to meet your God. Prepare to meet your God. Prepare to meet your God. Thank you, my friend. When this gospel's preaching, when God in his wisdom, who is now carrying the word by his faithful messengers, some things I tell you out here are not popular stuff, but I have to tell you. Some things I tell you out here, including tonight, you may not hear at your church, but you can tell God you did not hear it. You did not just come on your own to be here. God guided your footsteps to this place. Holy Ghost had a vested interest in getting you here. And if this is the only word your ears will hear, may God open your heart. But allow me to express my thanks. You know, I don't always say this, but we spare no expense in allowing God's word to go forward. God has been good to us. And every chance we get to reflect our love for him, it's our joy to do that. Can I tell you that, and since it's not yet vote of thanks, and I'm on my preaching time, so let me use some of it. I want to take time to thank, and I think you're listening to me, you're in Palm Bay, Florida, Rafael Harris and Myrna Harris, who gave up a part of their house so that we could get a place to put some Bible workers. Would you put your hands together for Rafael and Myrna in Palm Bay, Florida? We're saying it loud and proud. We love you like dumpling and ackee and saltfish. And thank you so much for your kindness. And there's a Beckford in Texas. I never got permission to call your name, so I won't call. When I get permission, I'll call the whole name. So I'm calling the last name. Texas, USA. Thank you. And we look forward to receiving your loving expression. You know, when we got started, I came by here the day the tent was pitched. And I said to Teddy, as I marked out with him, we measure up the platform. I said, get all of the material and stuff. I didn't know that the ply sheets and the wiring and the electrical stuff would have cost $1.1 million. When he handed me the paper, I went to a friend of mine in Montego Bay. I said, listen, I had no idea that the material for the platform and the wiring stuff would be so expensive. He said, what's the cost? And he took out his pen and he wrote the check and handed it to me. And I sent the check straightway up through the bank to the crusade team. God has been good to us. And there are persons whom God has blessed, and they have no problem expressing their love to God by giving generously to the cause of Christ. And I won't call his name. I don't want to set him up. If I call his name, somebody may go knock on his door. But my friend knows, and I know he's watching, and so if I use a first letter and a last letter, I'll just say DM. Thank you so much, my friend. Come here, my good friend. I have a good friend who every time you see him, what does he come out here and talk about? He's my friend. He's my friend. He's my friend. And every one of us, we have an assignment. Don't you know that? And his assignment is to tell you how good God has been to you. And to tell you that every chance you get to reflect your love for him, you do that in so many ways, including giving an offering. And so I see him with some brown envelopes, so I'm going to take one, put it in my pocket, and I'll bring it back on Tuesday. Now, look in there. So I don't want you to tell me that I'll bring it back with what you put in there. So you look in there. You look in there. It's empty. All right. So I'm going to take your empty envelope, and when I bring it back, I'll bring it back to you with something in it. And I wonder, do I have, I don't know, you may not have something with you, but I want you to join me as we express our love for God. If you put your hand right over here, you'll feel a pump beating. If you inhale and exhale, you know, there are some persons who, a machine is doing that for them. And we thank God for the opportunity. And say it again, sister, say it again. If you can breathe on your own, say amen. Amen. If you came here on your own two feet, say praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. And I'm going to ask him, if you're out there and you want to give a special love gift, if you raise your hand, he has good eyes. He'll find you. Trust me. If you raise your hand, he'll find you. So if you want to take one, you can take it home. You can bring it back on Tuesday or Wednesday or Friday or Sabbath. Even if you don't have anything at home, just ask God to bless you. And if he doesn't, then you don't have to worry. But if he does, then you reflect your love in response to him. And so mark him well. Oh, he's telling me that we're given already. I thought you'd give us some more. Thank you. But in case you didn't get one, he'll find you. Thank you so much. And is there anybody here, you love to cook porridge? Anybody here? Anybody here? He's running. He's I just look at my porridge-loving friend, you see? It's good to have you. And tonight I want to deal with, as I told you, an interesting question. Years ago, before I went to college, I was over in South St. Elizabeth. I love sharing the gospel. And I was over there sharing, and was way back in 1979. And a group of senior men sang a song that has never left my mind. Val Wallington and I think Hoover Daly and some others. Golden Voices. The song says, "For the truth and the right, precious Lord, have I stood. Have these hands done as much as they really could? Have these knees bowed low as oft as they should? I want to walk as close as I possibly can. Lord, I want to walk as close to you as I possibly can and do my best for my fellow man. And if I fail, let me feel just one touch of your hand. Lord, I want to walk just as close as I possibly can." That's the prayer of a loving child of God, to walk as close to Jesus as you possibly can. To walk so close to him that you walk in his footsteps, guided by the light of his word, strengthened by the Holy Spirit that he said he'll send into the world. Lord, I want to walk as close as I can. Is there anybody here like that tonight? Can I see you raise your hand? You want to walk? Oh, look at that devil. The devil is losing tonight. You want to walk as close to Jesus as you possibly can. And that's the prayer of a loving child of God, to have this mindset. You know, you would know this. Before I get out here every night, I pray for you. I'm walking out here with a prayer in my heart. I'm preaching to you with a prayer in my heart. And I believe with all my heart, there are honest people here tonight, members of other Christian denominations, wanting to walk with Jesus as close as you possibly can. Listen to me carefully. There are good people and bad people in every church, including this one. There are good people and bad people in every church, but there ought not to be any bad doctrine inside the true church of the living God. Jesus had 12 disciples. One sold him out and hung himself. There are good people and bad people in every church. But listen to me, Acts chapter 17, 30, 31 said, "At the times of our ignorance, God winks at, but now N-O-W commandeth all men everywhere to repent." Ignorance in the text does not mean hot-tempered like we use it. It means lack of knowledge, lack of a full understanding. And so he says, when you don't know better, when you don't understand everything, he winks at it. God will accept you even if you don't know everything, as long as you do what you know to be right. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 18 says, "But the path of the just is as a shining light that shineth more and more to the perfect day." My young pastor right over there, I just remember he was here. He told me he wanted to grow up to be a preacher like me. He's growing. He's walking in the light. It's shining brighter and brighter. He even got a baby. Are you listening to me now? The path of the just is of the shining light. Proverbs 4 and verse 18. What does it mean, preacher? It means that as long as you have a clear conscience, an open Bible, God will shine the light of truth in your path. The path of the just is as a shining light that shineth more and more to the perfect day. Listen to me carefully. The secret of a healthy relationship with God is to walk in truth as you discover it, even if it is something you did not know before. Tonight, I want to answer one critical question. Who changed the Bible Sabbath? Who changed the Sabbath of the Bible? I want to make a bold statement right up front. God has a Sabbath. God bless the Sabbath he claimed to be his own. The Bible is clear. If you have a Bible, Genesis chapter 2, 1, 2, and 3 is clear. It tells us that God is sovereign creator. The Bible said, thus the heavens and the earth. Our universe is so vast that mankind can't fathom the vastness of this universe. Our tiny planet that spins at 1,038 miles per hour and its axis as it moves around the sun in 24-hour period. Have you ever wondered that wherever around the world you go, every man's week has 7 days? Because God made the week. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished. 6 days he used to do that. And the Bible said by the time he got to the seventh day, he had ended. And then he says, and God blessed the seventh day. He rested. Can I ask you a question? Can God get tired? He can. Why then did he rest? He was setting an example for all of his children, for all of creation. Listen to me carefully. The weekly cycle has a break in it. If you were to work 7 days a week round the clock, you'll drop dead. So God, from the beginning, said, 6 days shalt thou labor, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. Now, he didn't make the Sabbath out of a rock, because we'd be searching for that rock. Had he made it out of a mountain, we may have to take a plane to get to the mountain. But God made the Sabbath out of something that all of us have equal access to. He made the Sabbath out of time. He carved it out of a 24-hour period from sunset Friday evening or sunset on the sixth day to sunset on the seventh day. The Bible said God blessed the seventh day. God sanctified the seventh day. Only God can bless. Are you listening to me? The word sanctify means to set aside, and in this context, for a holy purpose. So he blessed and sanctified the seventh day, and no matter what you do with it, as far as God is concerned, it is his holy Sabbath day. And if you don't do what God says, then someday somebody gonna have to pay. Because in it, he rested from all his work which God had created and made. That's the beginning of creation. Then when he wrote the Ten Commandments, he said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The only command that begins with the word remember. The devil knows if you remove number four, anything can be your God. Number four is the only commandment that tells you about the sovereign creator. Number four gives us the reason for Sabbath keeping. Number four gives us the name of our God. He's sovereign God. It's, beloved, I wish I could spend a longer time with you. He said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. He's God Almighty. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger, which is within thy gates. For in 6 days, wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Are you listening to me? He is the Lord God of heaven and earth. Are you listening to me? Beloved, the devil doesn't want us to serve the true God. The Sabbath tells us who the true God is. And every time you love God enough to honor him by making sure you don't treat the Sabbath as a common day, the devil hates that. Are you listening to me? I want to tell you that God never changed his Sabbath. God never altered it. In Psalm 89:34, he said, my covenant will I not break nor alter the thing that's gone out of my lips. And you can trust his word. Are you listening to me? He said, my covenant, I will never break it. I won't change it. The Bible said, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. Are you listening to me? Psalm 119 verse 142 said, thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness and thy law is the truth. God never did. And I know Jesus didn't do it either. Because Hebrews 13 and verse 8 said, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the same yesterday. Yesterday, he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue. It was his practice to be at a holy place or by the riverside teaching or preaching. Are you listening to me? He never used the Sabbath for regular concourse. The Sabbath is a day for blessing and healing and deliverance. Are you listening to me? God didn't do it. Christ never did. And I love Peter. We call him Chatty Chatty Peter. Sometimes he even talks before he thinks. Huh? You know what Peter said? In Acts chapter 5 and verse 32, the brother was in, he was reasoning and he was challenging the Jews. He challenged them how they took Jesus and by wicked hands they killed him. He challenged them and he said to them, listen, we know Jesus. We follow him, son. Let me hear my son. We know him. We follow him. We practice what he said. And Peter said, we are witnesses of the teachings and the example of Jesus, and so also is the Holy Ghost whom God has given to them that obey him. Peter said in Acts chapter 5:32 that he's a witness. He said, listen, I followed him. We are his witnesses of these things. And so also is the Holy Ghost. Now watch this, watch this. Peter is saying something here. He said, if you don't obey God, you can't get Holy Ghost. Now, me no write Bible, you know. Me only read Bible. And me know some people who jump and kick up and speak in tongues. I'm going to talk about that Tuesday night. I'm going to march down the Dolly House. Listen to me carefully. Peter said that God gives the Holy Ghost to them that
O-B-E-Y, obey him. Now, you can't claim to be Holy Ghost filled when you deliberately and blatantly disobey the commandments of the living God. Are you listening to me? I'm going to wheel and come again. God didn't change his Sabbath. Christ didn't do it. And Peter, some people say he might be the first pope, but a lie them a tell, because Bible not says so. Peter said he's a witness. He follows what Jesus said. He practiced what Jesus did. Kept the same Sabbath that Jesus kept. And he said, we are witnesses of these things, and so also is the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to them that obey him. Beloved, hear what John said. 1 John 2 verse 4, John says, he who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a what? I can't hear you, is a what? Is a what? He said, if you say you know Jesus and you don't keep the commandments of Jesus, you are a liar. It means that churches are filled with a lot of liars. The Bible says, what says? The Bible says, he who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments is a liar. Beloved, you ought to know the word of God. Verse 5 of the same chapter says, but whoever keeps his word, whoever keeps his word from Genesis to Revelation, are you listening to me? Whoever keeps his word, in him truly is the love of God perfected. But I love verse 6. Read verse 6 with me. He who says he abides in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he, Jesus, walked. Do you love the word, beloved? Do you love the Bible? So the Bible says, if Jesus declared that he blessed the seventh day, if Jesus said he would never alter it, if Jesus said, as his custom was, the only Sabbath he knew, the only Sabbath he kept was the seventh day, as his custom was, and Jesus is saying, if you say you abide in him, you ought to walk even as he walked. If you understand that, can I hear you say amen? Amen. It means every seventh day you ought to walk in the house of God as Jesus would. Are you listening to me? I said every Sabbath day, if you say you are abiding in Jesus, you have to walk just as he walked. Hello, somebody. Now let's go to Paul. Paul, that indefatigable, itinerant, powerful preacher of the 27 books of the New Testament. Most scholars believe he wrote 13 of them. He wrote some from narrow jail cell. He was beaten up and thrown in jail. But he never murmured. He never complained. Are you listening to me? He said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God to salvation. The Bible said in Acts 17:1, now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. Then Paul, read with me. I can't hear you. Then Paul, say it again. Say it again. He went, and three Sabbath days, reason with them out of the scripture. Paul had the same custom that Jesus had. Because Paul was walking in the footsteps of Jesus. Paul was abiding in Jesus. It means if you and I are abiding in Jesus, we've got to walk in the same custom that Jesus had. Are you listening to me? So when the Jews went out of the synagogue, now some folks say that the seventh day Sabbath is for Jews and Sunday is for Gentiles. Well, let's see which Sabbath Jews and Gentiles kept when Christ was here. The Bible said, when the Jews went out of the synagogue, the Gentiles who were in the same synagogue begged Paul that these words, the same words about Jesus, the same words about how he died to save us, huh? The song says, tell me the story of Jesus. They begged Paul that the same words might be preached to them when? The next Sunday. The next Sunday. They begged that the same words be preached to them the next Sabbath. Look at the next verse. The next verse said, on the next Sabbath, almost the whole city. Now how could the whole city come? It means that the Gentiles who were in church last Sabbath, who had fallen in love so much with the gospel, they went throughout the city. They did not want to keep it to themselves. They had good news of redemption, good news of pardon for sin, good news of obedience to Christ, and they could not keep it to themselves. I can't understand how some Christians come to church and them not tell nobody about Jesus. The Bible said, the next Sabbath, the whole city came to hear the word of God. So we can conclude, God never changed the Sabbath. Peter never did. Christ never did. Paul never did. So let me ask you in plain Jamaican parlance, a who do it? A who do it? Who changed God's Sabbath? Hold on there. There's one more text. I'm sorry, Maya. I didn't want to give you trouble. But I got to take it to Acts 20. Acts 20 is Paul's final meeting. He called the church leaders across Ephesus. He called them together. He called them together at one place. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached to them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. Hey, listen to me. You know that some folk use that text to say, Paul made the first day the Sabbath? I have meetings on Sunday. But because I have meetings on Sunday, it was not the Sabbath. Are you listening to me? I want to help you understand. I wish I had time. Read through Acts 20. And you'll discover that towards the end of it, he called them together. And he said, I may never see your face again. Preached. And never once did he ever mention anything about the change of the Sabbath. Are you listening to me, beloved? Never. He called them together, all of the church leaders, and he charged them. Counseled them, prayed with them, and departed. He knew the day of his death was near. I wish you could know when you're going to die. Paul said, later on writing, he said, I know the time of my departure is at hand. He wrote that to his son in the ministry. He would set up Timothy to carry on in his absence. He said to Timothy, I charge you before God, who shall judge the living and the dead, preach the word in season, out of season, rebuke, exhort, reprove, in all long suffering and godliness. He said, some will not, I love sound doctrine, but preach the word. Then he said, I know that the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Hallelujah. And never once did he mention anything about the change of the Sabbath. Who did it? I'm going to take you into history. But before I'm giving him trouble. Before I do that, I'm going to give an assignment. In Daniel chapter 7, God gave Daniel a great prophecy. He showed him some animals. And then God gave him an interpretation as to what these animals represent. The lion, the bear, the leopard. And he comes down to this, what he called the nondescript fourth beast. And to make it short, in Daniel chapter 7, I hate to rush, but let me, I didn't give it to him to put on the screen, so let me find it quickly and read something for you, because it's important that I anchor your mind in the prophetic word and the historical documentation. So, in Daniel chapter 7, I want to read from verse 17. It says, these great beasts, which are four kings which arise out of the earth. That's Daniel 7 and verse 17. Now he said in verse 23, thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom on the earth. Shall be what? He said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom on the earth. And he said, this one shall be different from the other three. The other three kingdoms were purely political kingdoms. The fourth kingdom was a mixture, a union of church and state, a union of religion and politics. It was a religio-political kingdom. And God does not make mistakes. God says, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom. Now let me talk to some history students here. The first kingdom was which one? Babylon. Second kingdom was which one? Media Persia. Third kingdom was who? Greece. Fourth kingdom was who? Rome. Now God is going to tell you that this fourth kingdom is going to attempt to change the very law of God. Are you listening to me? The Bible said he shall be diverse, meaning different. Verse 23 said, he shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it in pieces. Are you listening to me? I want to get to verse 24 and verse 25. Verse 25 talks about this issue that, sorry, I'm running fast, so listen fast. So back up while he finds it. 17 says he's the fourth kingdom. 24 said he shall be different from the first ones and shall subdue three kings. 25 said he shall speak great words, or what the King James said, pompous words against the Most High, and shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall think, this translation said, intend to change times and laws. Pope John Paul, in his last trip to America, he said, speaking of the years of his church's persecution, he said, there is a dark part of Catholic history of which he is not proud. Let me run to some stuff that may shock you. The Bible said the fourth beast would attempt to change times and laws. The Bible said the fourth beast would hold sway over the religious world. And from their own records tonight, I want to answer the question. Listen to this quotation from The Cretel, and this is a Roman, a Latin translation. The Pope has power, listen to this. This is their own writing. The Pope has power to change times, to abrogate laws, to dispense with all things, even the precepts of Jesus. I didn't write this. The Bible said he would think to change times and laws. The Bible said he would speak great words against the most. And here in their own writing, they said that the Pope has power to change times, abrogate laws, and dispense even with the commandments of Christ. I didn't say that. I'm going to give you more. Fasten your seatbelt. In the Catholic Encyclopedia, Volume 4, page 153. Listen to me carefully. If your neighbor is talking, tell them, don't talk. When I call the name of a church, it is not in condemnation. It is referencing what they have said and to prove to you that God predicted that also. Say the Catholic Encyclopedia, Volume 4, page 153, write it down. You don't even have to go to the library. Go on the internet. Google the stuff. Look for it yourself. Don't follow stuff blindly or you will go to hell. Look for what the Word of God says and follow it. The church, listen to this. The church, after changing the day of rest from the Jewish Sabbath of the seventh day, who did? The church. And you sure know it's not the Adventist church. The Catholic Encyclopedia is telling you what their church did. The church, after changing the day of rest from the Jewish Sabbath of the seventh day of the week, made the third commandment refer to Sunday as the day to be kept as the Lord's day. It's the fourth commandment that says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Do you know how they get the fourth to be number third? Because they took out the one that says, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. That's why, beloved, you go to some churches and you find some image that people bow down to. Hello! You think I make it up? Hold on. More coming. Let's go on, son. Let's take it. It says, listen to this. I wanted to write this down. Whether you're Adventists, Anglicans, Baptists, Catholics, Pentecostal, Jehovah's Witness, write this down. The book is entitled Faith of Our Fathers, written by Reverend Cardinal James Gibbons, page 111 and 112. It says, you may read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, and you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of Sunday. Listen, listen. I'm going to be here Tuesday night, Wednesday night. I think tomorrow is enough day to call up your reverend, call up the bishop, call up the pastor, and tell them you're asking them for one Bible verse why they are leading you to keep Sunday as the Sabbath. Tell them you're asking them to give you only one. I wouldn't ask for 10. One Bible verse. And if you bring the one Bible verse from anywhere in the Bible that says God or Jesus or the prophets or the disciples change the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday, I give you $1 million. Listen to me. Listen to me. Well, he said I should up it. 3 million. Well, 5 million. I'm not condemning people. I'm condemning error. I'm not preaching on people. I have too much class for that. I'm helping you to understand. Now, I'm going to go. So the Advent, most churches, the Baptist church, I was a Methodist. All my family, Methodists, Anglicans, and Baptists. Listen to me. There is the Baptist Church Manual written by, I know the first, the one I had was written by the Reverend Dr. Edward T. Heascox. What I'm going to quote from is the Catholic's Convert Catechism, which is the counterpart of the Baptist Manual or the Adventist Church Manual. Because in the manual is set out the basic doctrines of the church for instructions for new and old believers. Are you with me? So we're going to go now to the Convert's Catechism of the Catholic Church. In that, and it's I have one copy of the new edition, and this segment is in the old edition and the newest edition. So let's go to town. Which is the Sabbath day? This is in the Catholic Convert's Catechism. What's the question? Read the question. Read the answer. Me never write that, you know. Which is the Sabbath? Question. The answer? Saturday is the Sabbath. This is in the Convert's Catechism of Roman Catholic Doctrine. The next question, and this is a question that every Sunday worshiper ought to ask. Hear me carefully. If you take Sunday as your Sabbath, this is a question that you ought to ask. Why do we observe Sunday instead of Sabbath? Answer. Can you read it for me? Who transferred it? Beloved, this is from the Convert's Catechism. It says because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Listen to me carefully. I didn't write it. Your God says he blessed the seventh day. The Bible said our Creator bless the seventh day, sanctify the seventh day, and enshrined in the heart of the Ten Commandments, number 4 said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. Are you listening to me? Why do we observe Sunday instead of Sabbath? Because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Let me go on. Listen to me now. 1995, May 21, published in St. Catherine's Catholic Church Sentinel. Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change that the church ever made happened in the first century. The devil is a liar. I don't know why. So it's right behind me. I was trying to read from the one before me. Let's read. Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change that the church ever did happened in the... Happened when? Let's read on. Come on, son. I'm waiting on my friends so that you can read with me. The Sabbath day was changed from Saturday to Sunday, not from any directions in the scripture, but from the church's sense of its own power. Hush up first. Hold right there. Hold right there. Who changed it? The Roman church. They said they transferred it from Saturday to Sunday. They said that the Sabbath was changed from Saturday to Sunday, not from any directions in Scripture, meaning you can't find any such direction in the Scripture. God never did it. None of the prophets changed it. None of the disciples changed it. Beloved, I want you to think. God has given you a brain. Use it. Stop, follow, error blindly. Hear the preacher. You can't tell God that somebody else lead you astray. He that hath an ear, let him hear. Are you listening to me? God will fix those who are leading you in error. How do I know that? Jeremiah 23 verse 1 says, woe be unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, saith the Lord God. But you can't blame the teacher. Why do I say that? Jeremiah 5, 31 and 32 says, a wonderful, a horrible thing is happening in the land. The prophets prophesy falsely, and the priests bear rule by their own means, and my people love to have it so. God says, some prophets tell lie, some priests tell lie, and some Christian people would rather have the lie of the prophet than the truth of the plain, thus saith the Lord God. But you know how the text ended? Jeremiah 5:32 ended with, what will you do in the end? What will you do in the end? Because you and I and every pope, every prophet, every reverend, every bishop shall stand at the judgment bar of the living God. Are you listening to me? And it is what is in the book that's going to be the standard on the day of judgment. Can I read something else to you? James chapter 2, 10 through 12 said, if you keep the whole law and offend in one point, you're guilty of all. Then he said, so speak and so do, as though that shall be judged by the perfect law of liberty. That's what God says. I'm almost done. Hang with the preacher. I'm going to go to the rest of the quotation. People, now. Let me tell you the source again. Let me tell you the source again. I'm done. I just checked my time and realized I'm 8 minutes over time. If I have to do the next part on Tuesday, let me wrap this up. People who think that the scripture should be the sole authority should logically become Seventh-day Adventist and keep Sunday holy. You know who said that? St. Catherine Catholic Church Sentinel. May 21, 1995. My time is up. I close my Bible. For the truth and the right, precious Lord, have I stood. I want to walk as close as I possibly can. I want to walk as close to Jesus. I want to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. I want to have the same custom that Jesus had. I want to follow the teachings of Jesus. Is there anybody up in here tonight with an honest heart, a clear conscience? Maybe you've never heard it before. Or maybe you've heard it, but somehow have been resisting or didn't think it was important. Do I have honest hearts tonight saying, God, this thing is bothering my mind, but I want to walk close to you, Jesus. I want to walk in your footprints. I want to walk side by side. When I used to be a little boy in AY, 1972-73, there's some songs I could sing. Hand in hand, we walk each day. Hand in hand, along the way. Walk, tell me the rest of it.
Walking thus I can and stray, hand in hand with Jesus.
Hand in hand, we walk each day. Hand in hand, along the way. Walking thus, I cannot stray. Hand in hand with Jesus. I want to ask you to stand with me tonight. Would you stand with me? We're closing the service on a solemn note. I gave my word I'll close by 9 each night. Should have checked my time a little earlier. Forgive me, I just realized that it must be 9. I ask you a simple question. You have an honest heart. You want to have a clear conscience. What I've read tonight is from the plain history books that you can find. I've read from the Bible that God never changed his Sabbath. Christ never did. I told you, I challenge you. If you can bring me one Bible verse from anywhere in the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, that said God or the prophets or Jesus or the disciples change the Sabbath from the seventh day to the first day, you can collect $5 million. Listen to me. I've issued the challenge around the world, and some folk respond by saying the Sabbath is not important. You know what the Bible said? In the earth made new, in the new heavens and the new earth, which he will make. He said, from one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before him. Do you want to be there? I want to challenge you. But I see the hands of honest people here. You've not been following the Sabbath. Maybe you've never heard it as clear. Maybe your mind was never challenged as it is challenged tonight. But God is looking down on you. And from the depths of your heart, you're saying, God, I want to be honest. Would you raise your hand? Maybe you've never practiced it. Maybe you've been going to church. I was brought up as a Sunday worshiper. I don't say this to condemn anybody. But I wanted to know God Almighty means what he says. I want to pray with you. I'm challenging your honesty. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. Is there another? My time is gone and I have to pray. I have to close. Are these the only honest hearts here tonight who truly want to follow what God says? I see your hand. Let us pray. Oh Lord our God, we gave our word. We're closing tonight. These folk can get home, can contemplate your word, can contemplate the seriousness of the issue of the Sabbath. Lord, spare our lives. Bring us back on Tuesday evening to complete the subject. Who changed the Bible Sabbath? to answer the question, is it important that we do what the Bible says? There are honest folk tonight. Some have raised their hands. Some are deeply troubled, disturbed by the truth they're hearing. And yet, God, you do not send truth to condemn. You send truth to set us free. You send truth to liberate captives. You send truth, God, so honest people can know the truth, and the truth will set them free. I pray, Lord, for every person underneath this tent, for those online, for those on the outside. Some have heard these things before and may have brushed it aside as not being important. Some have heard it before God and their conscience is bothering them. Some are hearing it for the first time tonight, and with their mouth wide open, they're wondering, how come they didn't know these things before? Take us home safely. Watch over us while we sleep tonight. Give us a good day tomorrow. God, keep us safe. Bring us back on Tuesday evening. There's going to be a baptismal service here. Lord, we praise your name for all those already baptized. Some on Sabbath had challenges and changed their mind. But defeat the devil, we pray. Bring them out tomorrow night, Jesus. You're giving one more opportunity. Bring them out on Tuesday night to seal their commitment right in the baptismal pool right here. Defeat the devil. Grant your children the victory. Lord God of heaven, I'm praying for that man over on my right. I don't know his name. I'm praying for that man down toward the center. Praying God for these ladies right in the middle toward the front. I'm praying God for those over on my left. You've put it in my heart as my eyes made contact with them. Open their minds. Grant them, Almighty God, the power of the Holy Spirit to make the decision to trust and obey. For when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his sweet will, he abides with us still, with all who will trust and obey. Send us home tonight, God, with the thought on our minds, trust and obey. For there is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Thank you for your mercies to us. Keep us safe, we pray, in Jesus' name. May the Lord God bless you. I plan to send you home by 9 o'clock. I must confess my time caught me. I didn't look at it. Never had a clock before me. And by the time I look at the watch on my phone, it was already 8 minutes after 9. Good night, everyone. God bless you. Walk hand in hand with Jesus. Bring a friend with you. And come on Tuesday night with your mind made up. Yes. Walk hand in hand with Jesus. Bring somebody with you on Tuesday. There's going to be a baptism out here. Come in the name of Jesus. Come guided by the Spirit of Jesus. Good night, everyone. Be safe on your way home. The Lord God bless you. The Lord God keep you. The Lord God cause his face to shine upon you. Walk hand in hand with Jesus. Hand in hand along the way. Walk in the footprints of Jesus. Trust and obey. Walking thus, you cannot stray. As you walk hand in hand every day.